Welcome to Front and Center with Jacquie Jordan.
Is artificial intelligence our last invention?
I think what bothers the owners most is that they weren't told and it was a major shock. It was a very stealth operation.
This is Front and Center with your host, Jacquie Jordan.
Entertainment and pop culture expert Jacquie Jordan is with us.
Two-time Emmy-nominated Hollywood producer Jacquie Jordan.
We are the show where we talk with the change agents, the storytellers, and the activators making impact from behind the scenes. Welcome to Front and Center with Jacquie Jordan. I'm Jacquie Jordan. This is the show where we work with the change agents, the storytellers, and the activators from behind the scenes making impact. In this show, we talk with the storytellers and change agents that affect collective narratives. One of the social media influencers that I've been following on Instagram is Justine Bateman, known for her role as Mallory on Family Ties. It's definitely a Generation X reference. Well, she's been most recently seen on the Today Show. She's been talking about aging gracefully without any interference and has been transparent as such on social media and really kind of criticized and bashed, but she's holding her own with it. The other issue that she's holding on social media, which I found very fascinating, is how artificial intelligence is affecting art, and she really is pushing to draw a boundary there. And why this is so significant to me, as I have the privilege of being a co-author with an NYU adjunct professor at the Stern Business School, Darren Campo. And he's also a sci-fi writer and a good dear friend of mine and colleague, and we co-wrote a book called Artificially Intelligent. Drawing the lines of boundaries where AI is concerned is becoming a very, very important conversation. One of the other things I hold in common with my dear friend is love of architecture and anything alien, sci-fi, and how it affects our culture, our conversation. And he lives in a fantastic building that is drawing some very interesting attention in New York City, but it's one of those NIMBY stories. And later, we're going to talk to Joe Germanotta, the restaurateur of Joanna's Trattoria here in New York City on the Upper West Side. And he's also most famously known as being Lady Gaga's father. And he is working to salvage his neighborhood in the threat of the migrants moving in and what he needs to do and what he was looking for his civic leadership to do to help integrate this situation for all parties concerned. So we'll hear his thoughts and ideas. And is this a template for how we also can come together and unite and work out some of these really challenging difficulties that we're all witnessing and experiencing at this time? Also in the news this week, I just wanted to comment, is Sound of Freedom is with Jim Caviezel. I had the opportunity of meeting Jim Caviezel several years ago when Mel Gibson directed him in The Passion of Christ. And now he's in a movie that is called Sound of Freedom. And what is interesting, there's all sorts of things going on. Actually, this movie happened outside of the Hollywood matrix, which is, you know, what makes it so fascinating. It's also hitting the very hard and controversial conversation about child trafficking, which actually I've been very passionate about for a long time. And in fact, in 2018, I had the privilege of working indirectly on a bill that crossed President Donald Trump's desk, where he was holding third-party aggregators like Google, and it came through a backstage lawsuit, and other browsers and from the tech industry responsible for the sex trafficking. And most people don't know that, but when President Joe Biden came into office, it was one of those bills that was eradicated. The tech companies say it's too hard to police. But anyway, this movie, Sound of Freedom, is in movie theaters right now. And what makes it so interesting from a lot of levels, not only just from the story that it's telling, it's also about how the money for the movie was raised, which is different. There is some controversy about some of the backers, but what I can tell you is during COVID, I was doing a cross-country trip in Arizona, and I was crossing through the state and happened to really experience that there was a lot of grassroots funding for this movie going on. Anyway, there are other controversy is saying that there's some other ties to deep state in this movie. But regardless, the movie is doing really well in the box office. Nobody has said this, but I do believe, and I haven't read it yet, but I do believe that Mission Impossible, Tom Cruise delayed his July 4th movie opening to July 12th, because when would you ever hear of that happening, so that he wasn't up against this movie for sex trafficking. Interestingly enough, Indiana Jones did open up against this movie, and so far Sound of Freedom has brought in over $40 million. I just find that very fascinating. And also, I wanted to flag the documentary that I watched, the documentary on Arnold Schwarzenegger. And it's well done in terms of how the content is broken up. It's his bodybuilding career and how he got from a small village in Austria to Los Angeles, California, and that journey. Then the second episode is about his movie career, which of course is epic. It's, you know, it was like him and Sylvester Stallone in the 80s, and we all grew up to these big, they became action movies, these action hero movies that we all grew up with. And then he talks about his political career in the final episode. And then the underlying tone to the movie was the fact that he had fathered a child outside of his marriage with Maria Shriver, and having to work through that. And basically he said that you can have all the success in the world, but if you're not successful with your family, you're not successful, which lends to my final guest, which is Joe Germanotta, which is Lady Gaga's father, and the fine line that he walks for that. But up next on Front and Center, we've got my friend, sci-fi author and co-author of Artificially Intelligent, Darren Campo. Stay tuned.
When you say AI, you think, oh my God, that's just a black screen with tons and billions of lines of code. I can't understand that. That's not for me. So what we wanted to do is write a book about how do we coexist with technology.
Now we all know what it's like to be on the Texas border.
Welcome back to Front and Center. We are the show where the change agents, the storytellers, and the activators from behind the scenes make impact with us. Now take their seat front and center. Joining us is my good friend, Darren Campo. He's a professor at New York University Stern School and the author of several sci-fi books. And I've had the privilege of being the co-author of an upcoming book called Artificially Intelligent. Please welcome my dear friend, Darren. So let's talk about our upcoming book, Artificially Intelligent. What a story are we telling to everybody in this book that about technology and that they're having in their hand?
When you say AI, you think, oh my God, that's just a black screen with tons and billions of lines of code. I can't understand that. That's not for me. So what we wanted to do is write a book about how do we coexist with technology? And when we were doing the research on this, it really blew my mind, because we go back 2,000 years and find out that Plato said in his dialogue with Socrates, he said, you know, this written word thing is really not going to be good for humans, because people are going to think they know things because they read it, but not because they experienced it. So it's not real knowledge. And they're going to be know-it-alls that are really obnoxious to be around. So Plato said that 2,000 years ago. It didn't just happen with 24-hour news networks.
You know, one of the things you talk about in the book, which I really like, which was we explain natural technology and computer technology. Like, what are the, and I also see them as timelines sometimes. Like, you know, are we on an organic timeline? Or are we on a technology timeline? You know, AI timeline.
Exactly. So this is the big question that everyone asks. Every day on the news you hear now is, artificial intelligence, our last invention? Is it going to take over? And, you know, a few months ago, all of the heads of these big companies, including Elon Musk, said, we should have a 6-month moratorium. This is so dangerous. And from the research that we did for this book, it seemed like it was just a lot of fear mongering, because there are a lot of very interesting philosophers who understand the big lines of code that say that artificial intelligence, the way it is now, just can't really ever achieve the kind of consciousness it would need to have organic learning to be a real threat. Now, there could be accidental things that happen, but we've dealt with those, and we go through in the book all of the different technologies that have come across over the last century and how we've dealt with them. And so the reason that we're asking these questions about the dangers of artificial intelligence now is because we have a lot of experience. So there's a lot of reason in the research and in the history that we can be a little more optimistic than the news is on all of these things.
When you were last on Front and Center, it was 2019, yeah. Way before the panic. Well, that was a panic too, the pandemic. And, you know, as a NYU professor, you work with younger people than us. The Gen Zs were more of the Gen Xs. So I just want to pull a clip from our last appearance. Take a look.
I do all my research on the subway, and on the subway, you know, everyone's on the subway. And one of the first things I noticed when Kindle came out, and this has got to be over 10 years ago, was the only people on the subway who had a Kindle were the older people. And I don't know if it's because of the reading or because they were able to adjust the font size or bring all their books with them. But there have been so many instances where I've seen technology adopted. The early adopters were not the generation you think it would have been.
Has anything changed in terms of the younger generation with AI, especially because we've seen the infiltration of AI in the last couple of years?
No, and I think what the great point that you're making is that because of the necessity of that time that we lived through, everybody had to become comfortable with different forms of technology. And so through necessity, you find out, oh, this isn't a generational thing. It's actually just something that everyone may feel more or less comfortable with. So I still maintain there's really not a generational difference in technology. I think that's something that's been suggested to us that we bought without looking into it. But again, if you go on the subway and you look around at what people are doing, there's no division in age group between what people who are playing video games on their phone. Now, older people may still be playing Candy Crush, but they're still playing video games on their phones.
It's true.
I don't see so many Kindles anymore on the subway.
Isn't that true?
Yeah.
What happened to them?
I don't know. You know what I think happened? I think podcasts happen. I think you download podcasts now.
And it's easier to listen to. Or audibles.
Yeah.
It's easier to listen to a book now than it is to read a book.
Absolutely.
Yeah. One of the things we talk about, or the polarity that you and I kind of pulled on when we were writing this book together, is I always wanted to take the dystopia view.
You like to be pessimistic.
Yeah. And you were like, Jacquie, it's not there. Why?
There's some really influential people in this that we got to look into and know about. So Bernardo Castro, Rupert Sheldrake. Now, Rupert Sheldrake is an amazing scientist. He came up with the idea of the morphogenic field. And this came from the observation that animals in one part of the world, for example, in the UK after World War II, they had stopped delivering milk bottles. And the birds before World War II knew how to take the cap off and drink the milk. Enough time went by that the generation hadn't, there was no way they could have learned that. But they, once the milk bottles came back, the birds started doing it. They knew it already. So he started looking at other animals in different parts of the world. And so when one animal would do something on one island, another set of animals on a completely separate place would start doing the same behavior. And then he started noticing this with humans. Once the 5-minute mile was run, a lot of people were able to do that. So it seems that once something is achieved, becomes part of, you could call it a zeitgeist, but he calls it a morphogenic field. And he has this great book called Seven Experiments. One of them is, does your dog know when you're coming home? Because I think everybody who has a dog understands. And the way they do the experiment is not based on anything that's rational, like the sound. It could know the sound of your car, could know your schedule. He's talking about dogs where someone's gone for 3 months, doesn't call and let them know you're coming home. So this morphogenic field is part of natural intelligence. It's a huge part of human natural intelligence, living things natural intelligence. It is not inherent in a silicon-based intelligence or in a digital intelligence. And therefore, what we have with artificial intelligence now is based on, ones and zeros. It's based on transistors, if the electricity can go or not go. And so there's no emergence of a morphogenic field. And that's the greatest part of human, animal, and natural intelligence. And what we discovered writing this book, Artificially Intelligent, is that you really need a biological-based computer or a quantum computer that has all of the things that were part of natural intelligence to get something that could really be not just a threat, but also a companion and another actual you know, another species.
You're in a building, the Order of the Pythias, which is a famous building in New York that most people don't know
about. The Pythian Temple. Yeah, the Pythian Temple. It's on West 70th Street. It was a temple built in the early part of the 20th century. And the amazing thing about it is that they were very secretive, so there really aren't a lot of pictures. We did uncover a few, but it's designed by Thomas Lam, who was the same person that designed the Chinese Theater in Hollywood. So when you look at the outside of the building, you see these big pharaohs sitting outside, and you see a lot of Egyptian adoration on the building, which
sure.
all has some sort of Masonic meaning, because the Pythians were a branch of the Masons. So
right.
It's, but also, so something about the building sparks a lot of creativity, because we've had, this used to be a recording studio. It was Decca Records before it was a condominium. A lot of famous songs were made here. And then we had a lot of musical residents, including Lady Gaga grew up in the building.
That is amazing.
So we're waiting for it to rub off on me. And if you stay here long enough, we may have some extra talents coming out.
Well, I really appreciate you joining us today on Front and Center, and really love the fact that I had the opportunity to co-author this book with you. Artificially Intelligent, TV Guestbook Publishing, written by Darren Campo, co-authored by me, Jacquie Jordan. You can find out more information on Amazon or any place that you find your favorite book, because we love supporting bookstores. And if you would like some more information about Front and Center, you can subscribe to us on YouTube or any place that you listen to your favorite podcast.
It was quite a shocker to us, because our local officials didn't really share any information with us.
Alex Detail was a child genius who saved the world from the evil harvesters. But a decade later, this mysterious alien force has returned, and Alex is no longer a prodigy. Now, in order to save the world again, he must survive his kidnapping, fight his evil clone, and get his ship to the planet Pluto, where he will uncover the universe's ultimate power. Alex Detail's Revolution, a thrilling new novel by Darren Campo. Buy online or wherever books are sold.
Welcome back to Front and Center. I'm Jacquie Jordan. We are the show where the change agents, the storytellers, and the activators making a difference from behind the scenes take their seat front and center. We're joined with a special guest today, Joe Germanotta, and we're going to talk about the issues facing New York. He is a behind-the-scenes activator making impact here, right here in the Upper West Side of New York. He raised his two daughters here. We know one of them as Lady Gaga, and we want to hear what his ideas and what he's doing behind the scenes here, and how the NIMBY, they're not in my backyard, NIMBY.
Nice.
Yeah, is the conversation, but you're really experiencing that right now in your own backyard.
Yeah, we are. I mean, it was quite a shocker to us, because our local officials didn't really share any information with us. So
there's no heads up?
There was no heads up. And so basically, even the students that were in the dormitory at the AMDA building, they didn't know until 2 weeks before they were asked to leave. And you know, they took them downtown, set them up, I think, down in the village, West Village. And then the next thing was, you know, 1-800-JUNK was here, and they emptied out the building. And 2 days later, they pulled up with trucks and they brought in bunk beds and et cetera, et cetera.
So okay. we're talking on the big picture. We're talking about the whole migrant issue has come right into the neighborhood, into the dormitory next door at the American Music of Drama.
American Drama Music and Dance, I think
Dance,
it is.
Right next door. And so it's changed the whole tenure of the street, the neighborhood. And so what are some of the issues that the neighbors are complaining about, or the impact that everybody's feeling?
First of all, let me thank some of the local officials that have helped us out. Gail Brewer has been tremendous. Linda Rosenthal, Mark Levine, the borough president. Who else? Manuel Belliard, who works for HCC. Laura Atlas, who most recently has helped us out even
and
more.
And how so?
Well, you know, we've had problems with motorbikes on the street, probably 50 or 60 of them, okay, just parked, unlicensed, during the evening and sometimes during the day hours. The residents of the building there would sit on their motorcycles with their girlfriends or wives or whatever, and they'd rev their engines, and so it was really affecting the quiet enjoyment of the neighborhood. Other things we've seen, you know, a lot more trash in the neighborhood, empty Bud Light boxes and empty liquor bottles, et cetera. Most shocking one the other day was there was a hypodermic needle.
Okay.
Okay. And unfortunately, those things, they were right out in front of Blessed Sacrament School, which is about 500 feet away from their building.
So we're dealing with a migrant issue. We see it on the news. We see it coming up the Texas borders. It's very different when it comes on your block and into your home.
Right.
And when people say to me, or complain to me, Jacquie, we really need to bring, do something with these migrants or bring my immigrants in. I'm always for a legal system. I said, if we don't like the legal system, we need to change it or upgrade it, but not do it this way. But I always say to people, like, how many people could you put on your house before you're overrun? Like, how many people could you put in your sofa in your house before you can't afford to feed them? You run out of your own home resources.
Right.
And it changes the context. But this is kind of the same thing when it happens, in your street. So how are you working with the city officials that you named to get some sort of resolution? And what resolution would you like to see?
Well, we had a block association meeting, which we just started as a result of this, but it's really turned out to be a benefit for everyone. And we invited Gail Brewer and a couple of the other city officials.
And they don't always get along either.
No.
Right?
But
so the fact that you're bringing it together.
We're bringing them together and we're giving them, we're sharing ideas with them, all right? And they're telling us what they can do. And then what they may be able to do. I mean, one of the most significant things we asked for was, how about some additional block security? Because quite frankly, some of the residents in the neighborhood, not just in my building, they're afraid.
Right. Right.
Because late at night, there'd be block parties and people partying out there. Now, I will say this. Last night, one of our owners here came home at about 2 o'clock in the morning, and she said the street was quiet.
That's fantastic.
Okay.
That's good.
And we believe the reason to be that we asked them to increase the security. Now, for the longest time, their security was just inside the building. What we asked them to do is, hey, how about having your guys in the building, your security, just stand out front, maybe walk up and down the street every once in a while, and, just look for, how would I call it? Poor code of conduct activity. How's that? All right. And, that seems to be working. And the police department has, at times, they've sent some vehicles down the street. They've impounded all the motorbikes. They've taken them away, which is, that's another story. I don't know how.
They all got motorbikes.
Yeah,
exactly.
Okay.
Having been in Los Angeles,
right.
They had cell phones, debit cards for groceries, and they would also get their medications.
Well, here, at the AMDA facility, there's a food truck that comes every day. There's a laundry truck that comes. I don't know if they come every day.
But they're provided laundry services.
They're provided laundry services. And I don't know what else they get, but I can tell you this, the building that they're in only accommodates about 380 people. All right. Now they put bunk beds in there. Okay. That was single rooms of the 380. Now they put bunk beds in there. So I got to believe it. And they're shared bathrooms, shared facilities, right? There's no cooking on premise, thank God.
But you would imagine has to still be make fire code.
Oh yeah. I'm sure it's over the fire code. I mean, some of the unusual things that started happening, the residents, they're hanging their wet laundry out the window.
Oh, haven't seen that in a long time in New York.
But, those are manageable things over time.
The time, of course, right.
I mean,
the bigger issue is the safety.
And, fitting into the neighborhood. I think what bothers the owners most is that they weren't told, and it was a major it was a very stealth operation.
Oh, that's interesting.
Okay.
It was like
they were flying into Westchester and dropping them off.
Right. You know? DeSantis sent them into
Cape
Cod.
Exactly. And I think if we had had some advance notice, I don't know how, if it would have turned out any better.
But it would have allowed a voice. It would have allowed the neighbors to have a voice.
They would have a voice, and maybe we would have been able to, foresee some of these obstacles that cropped up immediately. But I will say that the city officials that we've been dealing with have been very responsive, and you know, we can only thank them for that.
Well, that's great. That's great. You're getting the, you know, you're getting, you feel like you're getting heard. You're taking action, which is what we're supposed to do when we're not happy with
We want them to
leaders.
Fit in. I mean, we have the compassion for, you know, the neighbors. Okay. I mean, I can't imagine. Now we all know what it's like to be on the Texas border.
Right. Right.
Okay. That's just the fact of the matter. Okay. Right. So recently I spoke to Laura, and I feel that, you know, getting them more involved in the neighborhood would make everybody, put everyone's mind at ease.
Getting the migrants.
The migrants involved in the neighborhood. And, you know, I realize there's a little bit of a language barrier with most of them. Or I should say a lot of a language barrier.
Sure, I'm sure there's language, right? Cultural.
But what, you know, the suggestion we just made was, hey, why don't you guys pay for a block party? And we'll get everybody together. All right. And we'll show that, you know, everybody will learn. Maybe they'll learn each other's names and you know, it'll be more of a neighborhood event. Quite frankly, when the students moved in from the dormitory, I mean, we had some issues originally, but they settled down. I mean, the most significant issue was they'd come home at, you know, 11 or 12 o'clock at night, and they'd be singing, you know, show tunes.
And you've been here a long time.
I've been here 35 years.
In a very classic building.
A very classic building, very quiet, respectful neighborhood where people know each other.
Yeah.
I mean, you know all the store owners. They know each other. And you know, I have a restaurant, Joanne Trattoria, and I have a pretty good relationship with all the owners. And, you know, they were a little taken aback by it as well.
You know, in terms of city planning, you know, when we have to do anything to our houses, we have to go through a process.
Right.
You know, there's not many things we get to do that creates that change, either personally in our own spaces or in our civic spaces, where we get away with just doing it without, you know, permission, neighborhoods. I mean, even, you know, sometimes you just make alter your house, you've got to get your neighbor's permission.
Yeah. I mean, we have a community board.
Yeah.
Right. And it's a functional board. You know, if somebody wants to open up a liquor store or a restaurant, okay, they have to go before the community board and get approval. There's rules about you can't be so many feet from a school or a church, et cetera, et cetera. I get it. They need the space.
Right.
Okay. But this was really close to an elementary Catholic school.
Right. Well, Blessed and you Sacrament. Weren't notified, I think, is the biggest, yeah. I think is the biggest, one of the many, but the biggest is nobody was notified.
Nobody was notified.
So you can't ask questions. You can't put in your own needs or wants with the community or the civic community. So right now we're talking about having possibly a block party.
I'm trying to get them to pay for it.
Yeah.
I said, well, if they have $2 billion budget, I'm sure they could squeeze $2,500 out of it to pay for a block party.
Right, right. Well, I respect your willingness to want to find a common ground.
We have a committee, all right, and I believe there's about 60 participants in the neighborhood. And the bottom line is we want to be fair and reasonable. Okay. We just want the city to be fair and reasonable with us.
Right. Well, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
This
was very nice.
And if you would like to learn more about Front and Center, please subscribe to us here on YouTube or go to frontandcenterpodcast.com, where we have all our past episodes. Remember to subscribe to us or hit your notification button to learn more about our upcoming episodes. I'm Jacquie Jordan. We'll see you soon.
Thank you so much for joining us on the Front and Center with Jacquie Jordan podcast. Please subscribe to us on YouTube and follow us on Instagram at TV Guestbert. We'd love to hear from you.
Alex Detail was a child genius who saved the world from the evil harvesters. But a decade later, this mysterious alien force has returned, and Alex is no longer a prodigy. Now, in order to save the world again, he must survive his kidnapping, fight his evil clone, and get his ship to the planet Pluto, where he will uncover the universe's ultimate power. Alex Detail's Revolution, a thrilling new novel by Darren Campo. Buy online or wherever books are sold.